Hello everyone, and welcome to my nerdy little corner of the internet.
Hi.
Oh, how?
Wow.
Today, we're going to enter my data nerd side and talk about this inkpot theory. But before we get to that, we need to get some trading card terminology out of the way. I'm going to be saying plane on curve a lot during this video. What I mean by that is whenever you're playing a card on curve, you are paying for it the moment you're able to afford it. So if you are playing Robin Hood, for example, and you need to play him on curve, means when you get 6 resources, you play him immediately with no extra resources.
Holy hallelujah of a curve!
Now, not every deck plays on curve, but the majority of aggro decks do, because aggressive decks need to be able to use all their available resources in order to get ahead on board and pressure the opponent. While control decks aren't as necessarily reliant on playing on the curve, this is just a good way to understand this theory and the data behind it, or else I would have massive charts and unbelievable number of data. What is the inkpot theory? Well, the inkpot theory came out around the beginning when Lorcano was first announced early September of 2022.
Do you remember?
Keep in mind that this is just a theory.
It's just a theory.
Nothing's been set in stone. I just like data so much that I decided to do this.
Nerd.
So, what is it? Well, in the inkpot theory, you have a secondary deck that is your resources. And this 15-card deck is going to have ink cards that contain one of the 6 elements.
Amber?
Ruby! Sapphire!
An amethyst.
Emerald steel.
You can have any number of each ink card inside your deck, but it has to total up to 15, and it has to be shuffled at the start of the game.
Shalt thou count to 3? No more? No less.
The first player puts the top card of the deck into play. Afterwards, the player whose turn it is, at the beginning of their turn, puts the top 2 cards of their inkpot deck into play. So the first player gets 1, then the second player has 2, then 3, then 4, then 5, and so on, until eventually everyone has 15 resources in play. You can then exert these ink cards to gain resources. For example, you need to exert 6 resources in order to play Robin Hood. So you need to have 6 ink cards and put them in play and exert them, and you'll be able to play Robin Hood. But one of these ink cards needs to be Sapphire, or the color that matches the card that you want to play. So I know a lot of people, a lot of speculators have been kind of throwing this away because it's from 4chan, or it's from Reddit, or from other unreliable sources.
Anonymous sources.
As a person from the Magic community, I've learned that sometimes they're right. So I decided to look into the data and the mathematics behind this theory to see if it's an actual viable trading card resource system.
Let's take a look.
This first chart shows the probability of getting your needed ink on the turn you want it on curve. For example, we've been using Robin Hood. So say you have at least 8 sapphires in your ink deck and you want to play Robin Hood on time, on curve. Well, up here, we're going to have how many sapphire inks we have in play, or in our deck. And then down here is which turn or how many inks we have in play. So we have 8 sapphires, and we have Robin Hood on turn 6. That is a 100% chance of having a sapphire in play by the time Robin Hood is in play. But once we get down to, say, 3 sapphires, it's only 82%. And I've color-coded this to where yellow means there is at least a 70% chance of you having the correct ink on curve. The green is at least 90%, and the red is less than 70%.
Paint with all the color.
So with the yellow, you would expect to not have the required ink about 30% of the time. So if this is best of three, then you should expect to not be able to play him on curve at least one of the three games that you play. But Knive, what about multiple inks? I want to be like Twilight Lurkana and play three colors in my deck. Is that possible? Well, look at this fancy little chart here. So, say we'll have Ruby, Emerald, and Steel as our three colors. And here we have all the possible ways that you can list out the inks. The point is that these charts show the probability of having all three of your colors in play by the time you have this many ink. If you have 13 rubies, 1 emerald, and 1 steel in your ink deck, you're not going to get all three most likely until 15th, which until you have all of them out, which makes sense. But if you have 5 of each, then you have a 95% chance of getting all three colors available to you by turn 7. But Knive, what about resource deck building? I want to play 6 color, and or 2 color, or 4 color. Well, I have something for that as well. So I've built this deck building formula tab in order to help us make our Inkpot decks. Again, should this theory be true? So, say I want to build a deck to where I can very reasonably play Robin Hood, Mickey,
clack, clickly clack,
not Mickory, and Cruella in my decks. Now, Cruella costs 2 and is an emerald. Mickey costs 8 and is ruby, and Robin Hood is 6 and is sapphire. I want a 90%+ chance of hitting Robin Hood, a 90%+ chance of hitting Mickey, and everything else, and Cruella, I just want her in the deck so I can do whatever shenanigans I have planned when we learn more about the cards. So let's start off with Robin Hood. So Robin Hood costs 6. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come here to the card cost, click 6, and then I determine how many sapphire cards I want in this deck. So let's start with 4. Okay, that works out. This shows that I have a 91% chance of being able to play Robin Hood on curve if I have 4 sapphire inks in my deck. I kind of want to increase the probability of that, so I'm going to add in one more. 96%, that is a lot better. So now I have 10 ink remaining in my 15 card ink deck. So now I want to play Mickey. Mickey needs to be on curve at cost 8. Now notice that this sapphire probability has gone up to 99%. That means whenever I have 8 ink cards in play, I have a 99% chance of one of them being sapphire, so I could play Robin Hood at 8. I like the number 5 here, so let's try 5 ruby, because that gives me a 99% chance of having Mickey. So now let's look with the remaining, put the remaining ink as emerald here. And so let's see the probability of us having an emerald on curve for Cruella. Ooh, only 57%. So this is where we get to this idea of just like finagling the data and our decks so that we can increase the probability of Cruella here. So we had a 99% chance on Mickey, a 96% chance on Robin Hood, and a 57% on Cruella. But let's increase the probability with the emerald, and let's take down a peg on Mickey. It's still not enough, so let's take another emerald and replace it with Ruby. 73%, that's better. I won't be able to play Cruella on curve every time, but that's okay. And let's take a look at our probabilities for Mickey now. It is still in the green, 92%. So if my goal is to play Robin Hood, Cruella, and Mickey on curve, then this is probably the closest I could get to being able to do that in a three-color deck. So, how reasonable is the Inkpot theory? Mathematically, it makes sense. You're able to get up to three colors pretty reasonably. Once you get up to five or six, it's much more difficult, but again, that makes sense. You're spreading your resources out more often. One concern is aggro decks, as say Captain Hook is a steel and only costs one, so you need to have a steel ink in play on turn one in order to play him on curve. But I think the idea of the mono ink decks are plausible. In Magic the Gathering, most aggro decks are mono-colored or two-colored anyway, so this works out with the resource management of all of it. Control decks can easily become 5-6 colors because they're going to want to slow down and get all 15 of their inks out. So I think this is a pretty viable resource management mechanic for a trading card game, and I wouldn't be upset if this is actually true to Lorcana. If it's not true for Lorcana, maybe another trading card game can use this, because it's actually pretty decent. But tell me what you think. Make sure to like and subscribe, and comment down below what you think about the Inkpot theory. And I'll see you next time. Bye!